So I took a look at some questions from a Korean university entrance exam, and I was pretty shocked by how hard they were. This is the CSAT, and I guess it's the South Korean version of the American SAT, which you may be more familiar with. But I think this Korean exam ranks as much more difficult and is right up there with some of the world's toughest exams. It is taken by Korean high school students, and the score determines which university they can go to. It is very competitive because many in Korea believe that a university's ranking makes a huge difference to one's career prospects. To get into those top unis, you might only be able to get one or two questions wrong on the whole exam, but that becomes seemingly impossible when you realize that the exam covers five different topics on one day and takes over 8 hours to complete. I think one of the most difficult sections is mathematics. It covers calculus with limits, derivatives, integration, trig calculus, even integration by parts, plenty of conic sections, vectors, dot products, 3D geometry, probability, and statistics. And students would get 3 to 4 minutes to solve each question. For question 15, we are told that two functions, y equals a to the x and y equals root 3, meet at the point A. There's also this point B, which is at 4, 0. And we're asked, what is the product of all the values of the little a such that the straight lines AB and OA are perpendicular to each other? Now, if you ask me, that sounds pretty tricky. I heard the notorious questions hide near the end, so let's check out question 30 on this 2020 paper. What it says is that we have these two functions. One is a log and one is an exponential, and they meet at only one point, when little a can be said to be f of t. It's a function of this variable t. Then we're asked to find the square of f prime when t is equal to 1/3. Have a think about what you might want to do here. I'll come back at the end and show my version of a solution. But first, let's look at some other sections. There's also Korean, English, history, science, and some other optional papers. The English test starts off with a listening section, and for this, the whole country goes silent. No planes take off or land in South Korea for that 30-minute period. So that shows how seriously this exam is taken. For this recent question, they had to listen to what seems like a YouTube intro and identify the purpose of the paragraph. But later in the English section, the questions get a lot more abstract, with language that even a native English speaker would find intense. There's a question about an African proverb: "Till the lions have their historians, tales of hunting will always glorify the hunter." And there's this paragraph here, asking us about the fact that people don't usually think of touch as a temporal phenomenon, but it is every bit as time-based as it is spatial. The physics paper contains all the usual suspects, but seems mostly based on conceptual understanding rather than heavy calculations. Understanding an eclipse, how to determine the wavelength of a laser, and orbital mechanics. Here is just a glance at chemistry, biology, and geology and astrophysics. 500,000 students take the exam each year, but around 20% of those are people taking it again because they weren't happy with their previous score. Those students may keep studying for the same exam year after year until they can get into a good university and move on with their life. South Korea is an extremely well-educated country. Their performance, as well as enrollment and graduation rates, are ranked among the top few in the world. They have around 80% of high school graduates going on to university. So it may come as no surprise that there is also a booming private coaching industry centered around passing this exam. They call them hagwons or cram schools. So let's take a look back at that math problem. It seems you first have to be smart enough to figure out that if our two functions would look like this for the exponential and this for the log, that if they touch at only one point, it would be something like this, where the functions are tangent and do not intersect. So we could set our function 1 equal to function 2 to find that point where they touch. That will give us this star equation here, but that doesn't immediately take us any further. Instead, we need a bit of a brainwave that we can also set the derivatives, that is dy dx, equal to each other. Because at this point, since they're tangent, the slopes of each line would be equal. So we can differentiate each side and set them equal. Noticing that our right-hand side hasn't changed during this process, we can replace it with the definition we had for it earlier, giving us a version without any a and just t's and x's, which can simplify down to give us that all of this is equal to 1, and I'll call that square because we're also going to use that later. This might seem like another dead end, but we have to remember that we're being asked to find f prime of t, which I prefer to think of as dA dt. And how would we get a dA dt? Well, we could go back up to an equation that we started with, and if we were to differentiate both sides of this with respect to t, this little a in here, due to implicit differentiation, would give us a dA dt term. So that's how we can get it. I differentiate both sides of it with respect to t, remembering that a is a function of t, a bit of product rule, a bit of chain rule, and you'll end up with this. Now we're getting good at replacing this term in here, which crops up again. I'm going to replace it with the result of that initial differentiation, so I'll end up with this line here. Now really we want to get dA dt by itself, since that's what we're interested in. We can get rid of some of these terms by multiplying both sides by x minus t over t cubed. And also remembering that earlier we found that all this was merely equal to 1, because that crops up right here. We'll set that equal to 1. That simplifies things down quite a bit. A little bit more rearranging, and we get something for dA dt, which is the same as what they're calling f dash of t. And because they wanted f dash of t at t is equal to 1/3, we can put in 1/3 for our value of t, giving minus 8. And then they want all of that squared, so that would be 64. Perhaps the calculus and algebra involved here is not that advanced, but the way that it's arranged and the fact you need to keep going back to results you found earlier and somehow knowing how to get your way out of these seemingly dead ends does make this problem really difficult. Certainly a stretch to be able to do this in just 3 or 4 minutes. And remember, for this exam, just thinking that you can skip questions that are too hard is not really a feasible option if you want to get those top scores, because getting just 1 or 2 wrong on the whole thing can actually make the difference. If you want to rank at the top, I think you're expected to be able to do all of them. Best of luck to all the students studying for this exam or a similar one. Thanks for watching this video, and you can check out others in the playlist to see how other countries might do things. Thanks to my Patreon supporters for making this video possible, and a special shout out to today's Patreon cat of the day, Maeve.